Thanks for staying with us for this web extra. I'd like to talk a little bit about the tent city in Albuquerque. Anyone who watches local news or has spent some time downtown has seen that there is this collection of people living in tents near the Albuquerque rail yards. Jennifer, what does this tent city signal to you?
Well, it signals to me that there isn't enough capacity in our community for people to be sheltered and or housed. And we've talked about this for a long time at our national level with the National Healthcare for the Homeless Council, because the hallmark of the Healthcare for the Homeless model nationwide is to do outreach to camps, to shelters, and other places. So people have been camping all over this city for a very long time. We know that these concentrations seem to be new. They're upsetting neighbors. They upset everyone. It's not okay that people have to sleep out. I think it's important for us to listen to the people who live in camps or tent cities or these sort of consolidated places, which vary from, you know, high organization and self-government to none, sort of coincidental. I think what's important to listen to is what they say about why, what it serves for them that shelters or other services, institutional services, don't. There are a lot of rules to go to a shelter or another institution. Some folks have pets. They're their best friends and their family members. The pets that come to our site are the most well-behaved, unbelievable animals that I've ever seen. But there are a lot of reasons why those institutional settings don't work for people. And we hear them talk about the need for privacy, autonomy, a sense of community and safety, which is arguable, which some of the camps give people. So I think we need to listen to what's important there in that experience and then translate that to our street to housing commitment. There are people talking about sanctioning camps, and I think that that's a diversion of resources. So back to the street to housing model, how can we get those, how can we create circumstances where people get the safety, community, autonomy, privacy that they say is important to them?
Dennis, there's also a tent city in Las Cruces. Is this a growing trend in our cities?
You know, sometimes it is. I think it's a misguided direction of resources, as Jenny said. There is an allure and an attraction that we've created somehow community for a group of people, but it's such a temporary community that it's not a true solution. So I think really getting back to the focus of how can we get those on the street into housing as quickly as possible. And when we talk to the folks down on at First and Iron as well, they are people who have real needs and real interest in accessing resources if we, as Jenny said, listen to them and their needs. My shelter, we have an overnight shelter as well. We don't allow dogs. So if somebody has a pet, they're not allowed in. So some of those rules that you or I may not even find attractive, we impose on others in order for them to access shelter. And as a result, then they're left with the option of forming a tent city.
Right. I think shelters can also divide families. And that, of course, I don't know if there's any children living down there at the present time, but that could be another reason that some might want to live in a tent city, as it were called. But the thing I think is about dignity and sort of being somewhat empowered to just take matters into their own hands and not have to live by the rules of a shelter or to live under a bridge. The people that we serve, have really been beaten down, and I think that it helps them to some extent to be able to muster the resources to feel somewhat safe.
You know, and I think it's important to separate the homeless issue from criminal activity. I think a lot of people see health hazards, which there are. They see criminal activity happening, sex trafficking at times. Seeing that as separate, that's really a job for APD to address. And we are there as agencies providing resources to those who are experiencing homelessness, giving them access to that. And so not to lump all of those issues together, I think, is a really tricky but necessary path.
And do you think the tent city will change the conversation about homelessness among maybe other members of the community, local elected officials? Is it going to make the conversation a little different?
It forces the issue. It's in our face. If people are completely invisible, we don't necessarily have to feel compelled to talk about it. When people are driving by it, when neighbors are rightfully upset, that becomes the conversation.
Did you want to add something, Jennifer?
Well, I wanted to add, I think it is a great opportunity, and we're hoping to advance it. I think the more people pay attention, that we don't lose that opportunity to generate, again, the political and community will for meaningful change that will be high impact. I think, as well with Dennis's point about distinguishing crime that harms people and homelessness, which is not a crime, and then criminalizing homelessness with our policies and our laws and our responses to homelessness in the community. No sit laws, panhandling, loitering, vagrancy, public urination, those sorts of things. I have two bathrooms at my house. I don't know how many the rest of you have, but these are practical issues that we need to be able to address without criminalizing the experience of people who live in public space because they don't have resources.
Do you think that there's a way for, I think, a lot of people in the community, if they haven't been homeless or been at risk of becoming homeless or known someone, it's going to be really foreign to them. Is there a way to get a dialogue started, a different kind of conversation where they would have a little more personal knowledge about this issue?
I think as I speak to groups, it's becoming more and more one person away from the person you're talking to, that more people have within their own families somebody who has experienced either couch surfing, doubling up. And I think that has opened up the conversation in a remarkable way, because it's not an other anymore. It's someone that I know. It's perhaps me. And the conversation becomes personal and real. I've seen in the last, I would say, 10 years, especially during the recession, a lot more responsiveness of outpouring of care, concern, and realizing that this is not just a lifestyle choice. This is people in real need.
It's how we frame it. And I think we've always had that opportunity. We're learning, again, about how to talk about things and to talk to people we don't normally. We talk to each other all the time. So I think we're learning a lot about bridging that with real meaningful dialogue. And I think, you know, if you say how many, just think in your head, have you known someone when you were a teenager who had to leave home for a while? Do you know someone who's experienced domestic violence, your aunt, your grandmother? If you get on the list of kind of the circumstances or the precipitating causes of homelessness that make people vulnerable to homelessness, almost everyone can think of someone that has been in their life. It makes it meaningful, makes it personal, and it makes it much less other.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.